But I would like for you to consider, all of you, the most desolate place you can think of. And by desolate, it could be isolated, but it could also be something that's not habitable, something that's harsh. What place comes to mind that's really desolate?
Either the Arctic or a desert.
A desert or the Arctic, Ashley
says.
Technically, the Arctic is a desert. Yeah, technically. What about you, Pastor? What's the most desolate place that you can think of? And I'm going to open up the little slide presentation.
The South Pole.
The South Pole? All right. All right. Maybe the first picture I have is Siberia. Some people might think Siberia is very desolate, and it is, and it's cold and it's harsh. Sometimes in the summer, if you're in the lower degrees of Siberia, it can get green in the summertime, but Siberia might be considered.
Some parts of it can be beautiful.
And some can be beautiful, that's right. In fact, I think this picture is beautiful even though it's full of snow. Mm-hmm. Next slide. This is the famous Mount Everest. And a lot of people love Mount Everest, but nothing grows there. Mm-hmm. It's all rock, snow, and freezing temperatures, and little oxygen. Next slide is Death Valley, and that's here in our country of the United States. And Death Valley has temperatures that are really, really hot, little bit of rain to allow some plant growth, but there's a lot of desert there, and that's not very habitable. And the next slide is another picture of another area in Death Valley, USA, and so is slide 6 and 7. Now, slide 8 is part of the wilderness of Sinai. This is where the Israelites were encamped and moving about for 40 years. It's pretty desolate there. Now, they probably camped near an oasis and where there was water supply, but this is pretty desolate. Now, in slide 9, this is another form of desolation. This is the famous San Francisco earthquake, the results of the San Francisco earthquake in 1906. A pretty desolate place. Slide 10 is an earthquake, the consequences of an earthquake in Japan. Slide 11 is another picture following an earthquake. Pretty desolate. Next slide is lava from a volcano flowing into the ocean. And this is in Hawaii. Not very conducive to desolation, to living. Now, slide 13 is something that just occurred just a few days ago, a fire in one of the great skyscrapers at Dubai. And here's another picture of it on slide 14. And here you might recognize in slide 15 some more desolation. This is a flood in St. Louis just recently, in the past week. And another slide of that in 16. You can see even the highways are under water. McDonald's has water up to its ears almost. Now, the reason I'm showing this to you is because in our lesson, we're going to be talking about desolation. And here's a quotation from the Great Controversy, page 636. It is at midnight that God manifests his power for the deliverance of his people. Everything in nature seems turned out of course. The streams cease to flow. Dark, heavy clouds come up and clash against each other. In the midst of the angry heavens is one clear space of indescribable glory. Whence comes the voice of God like the sound of many waters saying, "It is done." This is quoted from Revelation 16:17. Next slide. That voice, the sound of many waters, shakes the heavens and the earth. There's a mighty earthquake, such as not since man was upon the earth. So you think about all the pictures you've seen about earthquakes. That's nothing compared to what's going to happen. So mighty an earthquake and so great. The firmament appears to open and shut. The glory from the throne of God seems flashing through. The mountains shake like a reed in the wind, and ragged rocks are scattered on every side. There is a roar as of a coming tempest. The sea is lashed into fury. There is heard the shriek of a hurricane like the voice of demons upon a mission of destruction. The whole earth heaves and swells like the waves of the sea. Its surface is breaking up. Its very foundations seem to be giving way. Mountain chains are sinking. Inhabited islands disappear. The seaports that have become like Sodom for wickedness are swallowed up by the angry waves. Babylon the Great has come in remembrance before God to give unto her the cup of the wine of the fierceness of his wrath. Great hailstones, everyone about the weight of a talent, are doing their work of destruction. And I'm reading this because this is desolation. The proudest cities of the earth are laid low, the lordly palaces upon which the world's great men have lavished their wealth in order to glorify themselves are crumbling to ruin before their eyes. Prison walls, where you might be, where I might be, are rent asunder, and God's people who have been held in bondage for their faith are set free. Graves are open, and many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth awake, some to everlasting life, some to shame and everlasting contempt. All who have died in the faith of the third angel's message come forth from the tomb glorified to hear God's covenant of peace with those who have kept his law, they also which pierced him. Those that mocked and derided Christ's dying agonies and the most violent opposers of his truth and his people are raised to behold him in his glory, etc. Let's go to the next paragraph. Thick clouds still cover the sky, yet the sun now and then breaks through, appearing like the avenging eye of Jehovah. Now, this is desolation. Think about mountain chains have disappeared. An earthquake worse than ever has occurred. Desolation is everywhere, and this will be the home of Satan for 1,000 years. Now let's start to study that lesson in the scapegoat. Lesson 12 of the sanctuary, and it starts with this text in Leviticus 16, 7 through 10. So let's open our Bibles. And he shall take the two goats and present them before the Lord at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. And Aaron shall cast lots upon the two goats, one lot for the Lord and the other lot for the scapegoat. And Aaron shall bring the goat upon which the Lord's lot fell and offer him for a sin offering. But the goat on which the lot fell to be the scapegoat shall be presented alive before the Lord to make an atonement with him and to let him go for a scapegoat into the wilderness. What we want to focus on today is this word scapegoat and this concept scapegoat. Next slide is a sweet little picture of a goat. If you've had goats and raised goats, they can be very nice if you treat them nicely, but they can be a little contrary also. Okay, next slide. Now on this Day of Atonement, he first offered a bullock as a sin offering for himself and his house. This makes an atonement for himself and his house. Then he offered a goat as a sin offering for the people. That's the part we didn't read. That's in verse 15, and we'll get to that in a moment. And together, these two sin offerings make an atonement for the holy place, or what we consider the most holy place, for the tabernacle of the congregation, and for the altar. And I have those verses there that tell us that. Next slide. Now, on this scapegoat, Aaron we're told, lays both hands upon the head of the live goat and confesses all the iniquities of the children of Israel, all their transgressions and all their sins, and puts them symbolically on the head of the goat. The goat is then led away into the wilderness by a fit man. The goat bears upon him, that's the scapegoat, bears upon him into a land not inhabited all the iniquities and is let go in the wilderness. Next slide. The bullock for the sin offering and the goat for the sin offering were then carried without the camp and burned, their skins, their flesh, and their dung. That's the big picture of the goats. Now, the word scapegoat, I'm on the next slide, the Hebrew word is one we've heard a lot. I'm sure it's familiar to all of you, Azazel. That's the Hebrew word that is translated scapegoat. And this Hebrew word is only used here in Leviticus 16. Azazel is composed of two Hebrew words. It's a compound word, so to speak. The first part is az. I don't know if you say az. I'm not sure how to pronounce that. But that means goat. And the second part is azel, which means gone. So putting these two Hebrew words together, we get gone goat, basically, in simple language. Azazel is the gone goat, the goat that's led away, the scapegoat. And we see this in the fact that the goat is led away. He's gone out into the wilderness. The concept, another thing to remember or to understand, the concept of scapegoat is in no other place in the Bible. It's only right here in Leviticus 16, used maybe 3 or 4 times. Next slide. Now, even though we read that this scapegoat was to make an atonement, quote unquote, the scapegoat has nothing to do with the atonement that you and I receive from Jesus. It is not a representative of Christ, and we know this because, next slide, the Bible tells us before the scapegoat comes on the scene that Aaron had made an end of reconciling. That's Leviticus 16:20. The sanctuary and the altar had been cleansed, verses 18 and 20. An atonement, the atonement, had been made. We read that in verse 17. And all of this was done and accomplished and completed before Aaron then laid upon the scapegoat the iniquities, the transgressions, and the sins of the people. So this scapegoat didn't make atonement for God's people, for the sins that have been confessed and pardoned. This scapegoat does something else. Next slide. We read in The Faith I Live By on page 213, as the priest, in removing the sins from the sanctuary, confessed them upon the head of the scapegoat, so Christ will place all these sins upon Satan, the originator and instigator of sin. The scapegoat, bearing the sins of Israel, was sent away unto a land not inhabited. So Satan, bearing the guilt of all the sins which he has caused God's people to commit, will be for 1,000 years confined to the earth, which will then be desolate, without inhabitant, and he will at last suffer the full penalty of sin in the fires that shall destroy all the wicked. Next slide. Now, from Great Controversy, we read these following paragraphs. While the sin offering pointed to Christ as a sacrifice and the high priest represented Christ as a mediator, the scapegoat typified Satan, the author of sin, upon whom the sins of the truly penitent will finally be placed. Next slide. When the high priest removed the sins from the sanctuary, he placed them upon the scapegoat. When Christ removes the sins of his people from the heavenly sanctuary at the close of his ministration, he will place them upon Satan, who, in the execution of the judgment, must bear the final penalty. Next slide. The scapegoat was sent away into a land not inhabited, never to come again into the congregation of Israel. So Satan will be forever banished from the presence of God and his people, and he will be blotted from existence in the final destruction of sin and sinners. Now, let's just focus or try to summarize just a minute. What we know about the scapegoat and Satan. 1 point, the earthly high priest placed the sins from the sanctuary on the scapegoat. Jesus, the heavenly high priest, removes the sins from the heavenly sanctuary and places them on Satan. This is summarized from Andreasen's book, The Sanctuary Service. And also, the scapegoat was sent into a land uninhabited, and Satan will be bound in a land uninhabited for 1,000 years until his destruction. Now I want to focus on these three things that the high priest symbolically places on the scapegoat. We read in Great Controversy and also in Scripture, on page 658 of Great Controversy, in the presence of the congregation, the high priest confessed over him, i.e., the scapegoat, all the iniquities of the children of Israel and all their transgressions in all their sins, putting them upon the head of the goat. Next slide. Now, what are the differences between iniquities, transgression, and sin? First of all, the Hebrew word for iniquities is avon, and it means perversity or a moral evil. So on the head of the scapegoat, the high priest Aaron is confessing the sins of Israel, their perversities, their moral evils. That's one thing. He also is confessing or placing onto the scapegoat pesha. That's the Hebrew word translated transgressions. And it means basically, now there are broad ways of using these words, but it can mean a breach between two parties. This transgression is a breach. So in the first place, it can mean that moral evil, those perversities of the human race that you and I show and exhibit and even cherish sometimes, those perversities, and the breach, he's confessing the breach or the transgressions of the people, that's two. Now three, sin, this is the broadest word, it's kata, and it's used in a number of ways, but in a brief way of looking at it, it means an offense and its penalty. In a broad way, it has more nuances. For example, Judah proposed that if he didn't bring Benjamin back to his father, that he would bear the blame. The word blame there is kata, the penalty, for example. And so here we have a very big picture God is painting about this scapegoat and what this scapegoat has put on him. All these evil perversities that he's responsible for instigating in God's people, all the breaches that, the breach that these perversities and sins cause, and also the fact that it involves its penalty. The word kata can mean the offense and its penalty. So we have this broad picture of everything sin, everything Satan has been responsible for being placed back on his head. Next slide. Continuing on in the Great Controversy, but in a different place, we read, After presenting the scenes of the Lord's second coming and the destruction of the wicked, the prophecy, and the prophecy we're talking about is found in Revelation 20. Ellen White is talking about, I should say, is found in Revelation 20, 1 to 3. And here we go, we're going to quote it. I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the key of the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand, and he laid hold of the dragon. Jonathan, can you picture this? An angel comes down from heaven with a key and a great chain, and he grabs hold of Satan, that old dragon, and he bounds him with the chain and casts him into a bottomless pit. And that means this old world, everyone has died by the brightness of the second coming of Jesus, and the righteous are now with Jesus. So Satan is left here, next slide, and shut him up and set a seal upon him that he should deceive the nations no more till the thousand years should be fulfilled. And after that, he must be loosed a little season. We know that this bottomless pit refers to this world in the state of desolation that is caused by the second coming of Christ. Remember, we read about mountain chains being disappeared, islands disappearing, a great earthquake, all of these things happening. She says streams stop flowing, and a great desolation has occurred. We read about in Genesis 1:2 the darkness that was upon the face of the deep. Now in slide 26 we are reading that the expression bottomless pit represents the earth in a state of confusion and darkness is evident from other scriptures concerning the condition of the earth. In the beginning, the Bible record says that it was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. So there's one support here in Genesis 1:2 about this bottomless pit being a great desolate state. Jeremiah 4:23-26 also gives us support for this concept. We're continuing to read. Prophecy teaches that it will be brought back, partially at least, to this condition. This earth will be brought back to this condition. Looking forward to the great day of God, the prophet Jeremiah declares, I beheld the earth, and lo, it was without form and void, and the heavens, and they had no light. I beheld the mountains, and lo, they trembled, and all the hills moved lightly. I beheld, and lo, there was no man, and all the birds of the heavens were fled. I beheld, and lo, the fruitful place was a wilderness, and all the cities thereof were broken down. That is taken from Jeremiah 4:23-26. And it's quoted in Great Controversy, page 658. Continuing on in Great Controversy, we read, here is to be the home of Satan with his evil angels for 1,000 years. Limited to the earth, he will not have access to other worlds to tempt and annoy those who have never fallen. It is in this sense that he is bound. There are none remaining upon whom he can exercise his power. He is wholly cut off from the work of deception and ruin, which for so many centuries has been his sole delight. Now you can read on. I'm not going to read on. You can read on in Great Controversy, page 659, about this experience of the 1,000 years. And you can read in Isaiah 14:18-20 some more support about this earth being a desolate place and the bottomless pit, so to speak, where Satan is chained and bound. But I want to go on to what is happening in heaven while Satan is bound here. Do you know that during those 1,000 years, between the first and the second resurrection, the judgment of the wicked takes place and Satan also. We are going to judge Satan. We're going to judge Satan and his evil angels while we are in heaven during that 1,000-year period. While Satan is bound in this desolate, ugly place, we will be in heaven judging the lost, the people who are lost, as well as Satan. Next slide. And we base this on 1 Corinthians 6:3, which says, "Know ye not that we shall judge angels?" At the close of the 1,000 years, the second resurrection will take place. Then the wicked will be raised from the dead and appear before God for the execution of the judgment written. Next slide. So we have three phases, and I'm sure as Adventists you've heard all of this. There's the investigative phase, which is going on now in heaven. Then during that 1,000 years, it's sort of like a legislative phase, judicial phase, where the penalty is meted, is determined. And then after Jesus returns to this old earth and makes all things new, will be the execution of the penalty that has been determined during the 1,000 years in heaven. So what punishment then? What is placed on Satan? I'm on slide 41. We know that he will be responsible for his own sins. He can't blame anyone else for that. But for the wicked who had refused God's mercy and done things their own ways and have been determined not to be fit for heaven, they are responsible for their choices. But Satan also bears a responsibility because he led them into sin. And so the punishment that Satan will bear during the execution of the penalty phase is the punishment for his own sins, the punishment that is determined of what he has been responsible for in the lives of the righteous, yes, and in the lives of the wicked. So there's a partial punishment for the sins of the righteous. He led them into those sins. He instigated them. He tempted them. We make the choice, it's true. Then there's also the partial punishment for the sins of the wicked. They made their choices, yes, but Satan was behind them, pushing them in to making bad choices, to doing things that were contrary to the law of God. Next slide. In other words, Satan will suffer for his own sins and for his influence in causing others to sin, and likewise, the unrepentant sinner suffers for his own sins and for the influence that person has had that caused others to sin. Next slide. Taken from Youth Instructor, May 9, 1901, we read, "The punishment of the sinner will be measured by the extent to which he has influenced others in impenitence." And that's a very solemn thought. Right. You and I, we all have a sphere, Ellen White tells us. We studied this when we studied Christ Optic Lessons and our talents. We have a sphere of influence that we are responsible for. And so if we lead others into sin, if we encourage others, if we dare others, whatever we're doing, we are responsible for the influence we have had on people and led them into sin. Now we can ask God to forgive us, including teaching damnable doctrines. That's right. It's a very serious thing. If we make it to heaven at all, and we have confessed our sins and realized how awful the things we have done and how it's hurt God and how it will never have a home in heaven, if how can we've lived maybe a century, and every day we are influencing people either for good or for evil. I was in mental health counseling for many years, and people would sit with me in my office. And I remember one lady in particular who wanted to do this thing that was wrong. And I could say, well, if the choice is yours, I could say that. But no, I said, you can't do this. It's wrong. You cannot do it. I knew she was a Christian. I said, God will not, that is not allowed in God's word. I forget how I worded it. But I'm responsible for whatever influence I had on people during that time. Of course, I didn't realize it as much as I realize it now. And I pray that God will have great mercy to me. But every day we are meeting people who we are influencing, and we are responsible for that influence. Next slide, slide 44. No Christian, this is Andresen speaking, no Christian wishes to sin, he abhors it. But Satan tempts him. A thousand times the man resists, and a thousand times Satan comes back. At last the man yields. He sins, but he soon repents. He asks forgiveness, but the sin is now recorded in heaven. But forgiveness is placed against it. The man is happy. He's forgiven. He has placed his sin upon the great sin bearer, who willingly takes it upon himself, pays the penalty, and suffers the punishment due the sinner. Next slide. Then comes the final judgment. The sin is blotted out. The man's record is clear. But what about Satan's part in causing him to fall? Has that been atoned for? It has not. Satan must pay for it himself with his life. See, there's no atonement for Satan and the things that he and his evil angels do. We can receive that atonement by confession and repentance of sin, but that's not available. There's no atonement. Some have mistakenly concluded, Andresen speaking, that if the sins of Israel are finally placed on Satan, he must have some part in the atonement. This is a great error. Satan has no part whatever in the vicarious atonement. The saints are in no way indebted to him. His bearing of sin is in no way related to salvation. His work is evil and only. As the Lamb of God, Christ bore the sin of the world. All the accumulated sins of men were placed on him. He is the Savior of all men, especially of those that believe, 1 Timothy 4:10. And this is page 195 in the Sanctuary Service by M.L. Andresen. Now, so Satan has no part in the salvation of us, no part in this great work of atonement. He bears his own sins and the sin, the partial responsibility he has had in causing each one of us to sin. Next Sabbath, Lord willing, we'll start with an illustration Andresen gives about this process of the scapegoat, what is happening. Now, the part that I wanted to get to be able to share with you today, was what came to my mind as I was driving into Smyrna this morning. And that's, we have up to this point, and rightfully so, been very thankful for the Day of Atonement and the work of Jesus as our mediator before our Heavenly Father. And this is a great work. This is a work that we're all thankful for, a work that we must become involved in the putting away of sin and the confession and repentance. But you know what? As I studied this concept of the scapegoat and what it really illustrates, I was so thankful for it because it illustrates the end of sin. It's put away forever. And if you have Andresen's book, The Sanctuary Service, I would read his chapter on the scapegoat. I've read it several times and was rereading it last night around midnight. And This concept of, yes, our sins are blotted out, put into the depths of the sea, never more remembered. That's wonderful and great, and we praise God for that. But more than that, we are cleansed. That's why sin never comes back again. It will never be here a second time. Because in this process of confession and repentance, we are made new. We no longer desire to sin. The things that we have clung to, our little cherished sins, the things that we do even today, if we are engaged in this day of atonement, Jesus cleanses us from that. As long as we surrender to Him, and we have to make the choice, yes, we have to put our will, everything depends on the right action of the will, and we have to will and to do that which is right, but He gives us the power, and He helps us when we're sorely tempted. Instead of, I was writing in another article, Ellen White says, don't sit in Satan's easy chair and say, I can't overcome, there's no use trying. She says, don't do that. We are to ask God for help, and it's immediately there. Now, where Satan still tries his thousands of times to get us to sin, and thousands of times we must go to our Father and to Jesus and ask for help, and then we must do something about it. Like when I have had clients when I was in counseling, I was the counselor, and had clients who were depressed and didn't know what to do. Well, we had a plan. You know, one of the things is we sing. Something about singing praises to God, of course, sends Satan flying. So we don't sit in Satan's easy chair, and we don't just pray and ask for help. We have to do our part also, and that might be singing a hymn. That might be changing our environment so that we're not where we're being tempted, etc. And I know we're getting over, and it's time to close. And I'm so thankful you've been with us. And we'll finish this up, this concept, this procedure of the scapegoat and what occurs next Sabbath. Okay, now we want to get into our lesson for today. No, we want to talk about sheep and goats. It's an introduction to our lesson. So I'm opening up sheep and goats, and I think this is important for us to understand. There are two texts that we're going to focus on. I'm on slide 2, John 1:29, which says, behold the Lamb of God. John is speaking. John the Baptist is speaking. And then in Leviticus 16:5, we touched on it last week, and we'll get back to it this week. Two kids were chosen, one for the Lord and one that was to be the scapegoat. And so we want to focus on lambs or sheep and goats today. Now this word, this Greek word in John 1:29, behold the Lamb of God, is omnos. I'm probably not saying it right, spelled A-M-N-O-S. That word is what is used by John. Omnos occurs four times in the New Testament, John 1:29 and verse 36, Acts 8:32, and 1 Peter 1:19. And always in these verses, omnos is used in reference to Jesus Christ as the sacrificial lamb. Now, in slide 4, the comparison to a lamb, the comparison of Jesus to a lamb, is used to describe the patience of Jesus in suffering as a lamb before the shearer. It's also used to describe His sinlessness as a lamb without blemish, and the efficacy of His vicarious death as the lamb that taketh away the sin of the world. So, the use of the word lamb, or omnos, is not used to describe someone who is helpless and dependent and defenseless as a young lamb. It's used to describe his patience in suffering, his sinlessness, and the efficacy of his vicarious death. Now, let's look at the next slide. There is another Greek word translated lamb in the New Testament. And that word, Ashley will probably recognize, is arnion. And one of the books that we have read over the years talks about arnion. That's a name that this particular book gave to Jesus. And that is a word used to describe Jesus, arnion. And only John uses this word to describe Jesus. And he always uses it in the book of Revelation, except for one time. So let's look at the book of Revelation, starting in chapter 5, verses 6 through 9. And we will see how arnion is used. Revelation 5, 6 through 9 says, "And I beheld, and lo, in the midst of the throne and of the four beasts, and in the midst of the elders, stood a lamb, as it had been slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth into all the earth. And he came and took the book out of the right hand of him that sat upon the throne. And when he had taken the book, the four beasts and 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, having every one of them harps and golden vials full of odors, which are the prayers of saints. And they sung a new song, saying, Thou art worthy to take the book and to open the seals thereof, for thou wast slain and hast redeemed us to God by thy blood out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation." And the word for lamb in those verses is arnion. Next slide. Arnion is used as a title of Jesus only in Revelation and occurs 28 times. The 29th time it's used in the book of Revelation. It's not used symbolically of Jesus. It's used literally about the dragon and the beast that spake like a dragon. And that's Revelation 13:11 if you want to look at. Now we're on slide 7. This word arnion, for example, is used to describe Jesus vicariously. He shed his blood in chapter 5, verse 6. He defeated death, chapter 5, verse 5 and 6. He is omnipotent. This lamb that John is using the word lamb is describing someone who vicariously shed his blood, who defeated death, who is omnipotent and omniscient, who takes over divine rule and opens the book. He takes the book out of the one sitting on the throne. He receives adoration. Remember, we read that. He establishes a nation. We didn't read that. That's in chapter 7, verse 9. This lamb overcomes demonic powers. That's in 17, verse 14. Next slide. This lamb judges. We read about that in Revelation 6. And in Revelation 13, the texts are there in parentheses. He is the Lord of lords and King of kings, and he conquers his enemies. This lamb does. He holds a marriage feast. He shares God's throne and rule over his people. And again, the only literal use of arnion in Revelation is in Revelation 13:11. The rest are symbolic representations of Jesus as the Lamb of God. Next slide. Arnion is used only one other time in the Bible, and that's also by John, but it's in the Gospel of John, chapter 21, verse 15, and it is used to designate God's people. Next slide. John 21, 15, 16, and 17. This is after Jesus is raised, and he's speaking to Peter, and he says, "Lovest thou me?" And then what does Jesus tell Peter to do? To feed his sheep. Now, in these verses, John 21, 15, 16, and 17, both arnion is used for lamb, but then another word is used for sheep, probaton. And that simply means a member of a flock. No age is implied, no youngness, no advanced age, and it just refers in this way, in this these verses, to followers of Christ. Now, we read in verse 15, let's open up to John 21. Starting in verse 15, we read, "So when they had dined, Jesus saith to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? He saith unto him, Yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, Feed my lambs." That's Arnion. Next verse. He saith to him again, the second time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? He saith unto him, Yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, Feed my sheep. And that's probaton. Simply some, it just means a member of a flock. Verse 17, he saith unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved because he said unto him the third time, Lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. And Jesus saith unto him, Feed my sheep. Again, that's probaton. Next slide. Next slide talks about the feeding. He uses two different words, to feed my sheep, feed my, is it sheep every time? I think so. No, lambs and sheep. Okay, so two different words are used to feed, and some people understand this just to be stylistic, so you're not repeating the same word again. And I won't take any more time on that. But on the next slide, I have a comparison of verse 15, 16, and 17 of feeding and the lambs, feeding and the sheep, feeding and the sheep. But we want to go on because there's an important lesson on the next slide about lovest. Jesus uses the word agapeo when he asks Peter, lovest thou me? He's saying, do you, if we can say it in an easy way, do you agape me? Peter answers, not with agapo. He says, I phileo you. In a word, that's an affection. I have a deep affection for you. Jesus comes back the second time. Do you agapo me? And Peter answers, you know, Lord, I phileo you. I'm not saying the Greek correctly, I'm sure. The third time Jesus now says, do you phileo me? And Peter says, grieved in his heart, you know I do. And the difference between these words on slide 14, agapeo means to have a strong, non-sexual affection and love for a person and their good, especially characterized by a willing forfeiture of rights and privileges for another in another person's behalf. You're willing to deny yourself because you love another person. Whereas phileo means to have a great affection or to care for or a loyalty towards someone. And this is what Peter is saying. You know I have a great affection. You know I have a loyalty for you. You know I care about you. But Jesus is asking for more. He is asking for us to be willing to give up ourselves for him, to do his will. And that's such an important lesson for us today, because Peter may not have understood all of that. Many people haven't understood all of that, but we who are living at the end of time, we must have a love for our Heavenly Father and our Savior Jesus Christ, where we are willing to deny ourselves for their benefit, for their worthy to show their worthiness before the universe. And so we need to be able to say, yes, Jesus, and yes, our Heavenly Father, we agapo you, not just phileo you. We affection is fine, but we need to have a principle of love that will not be swept away by all the chaos we will experience in the future. Okay, now we want to open our lesson on the scapegoat. We want to finish this, if we can, in the next 20 minutes or so. And just to review, we read Leviticus 16:8 last time, among other verses in Leviticus, where it says, "And Aaron shall cast lots upon the two goats, one lot for the Lord, and the other lot for the scapegoat." And there's a picture of the goat, but let's move on here. And this is taken from Andreessen's The Sanctuary Service, page 193. This is from Andreessen's The Sanctuary Service, page 193. And this is the expanded version that was published in 2007, I believe. Someone had a question last week about that. I have the original version, but I've been using the more recently published one because I thought that might be more available to other people. And it also has additional notes in the back. So, this is what Andreessen says. "No Christian wishes to sin. He abhors it. But Satan tempts him. 1,000 times the man resists, and 1,000 times Satan comes back. At last, the man yields. He sins, but he soon repents. He asks forgiveness. The sin has been recorded in heaven. The man, now forgiveness is placed against it. The man is happy. He is forgiven. He has placed his sin upon the great sin bearer, who willingly takes it upon himself, pays the penalty, and suffers the punishment due the sinner." Next slide. Then comes the final judgment. The sin is blotted out. The man's record is clear. But what about Satan's part in causing him to fall? Has that been atoned for? It has not. Satan must pay for it himself with his life. Next slide. Some have mistakenly concluded that if the sins of Israel are finally placed on Satan, he must have some part in the atonement. This is a great error. Satan has no part whatever in the vicarious atonement. The saints are in no way indebted to him. His bearing of sin is in no way related to salvation. His work is evil and only evil. As the Lamb of God, Christ bore the sin of the world. John 3:16. All the accumulated sins of men were placed upon him. He is the Savior of all men, especially of those that believe. 1 Timothy 4:10. Now we have an illustration. This is where we stopped last week. We have an illustration to share from Andreessen. It's paraphrased and edited a little bit, so it's not in quotes. "A sinner repents, seeks God earnestly, and receives forgiveness. In the day of judgment, the sin is blotted out, and even the record is no more. The sinner stands before God as if he had never sinned, clad in a robe, pure and white, a new creature. His sin is washed away. But what has happened? The death penalty which hung over the sinner has been removed. Christ has died for the sinner, died in his place. He has taken upon himself the punishment which was due the sinner. He has suffered for the sinner's sake, and by his stripes the sinner is healed. Christ has taken his sin with him into the grave. There he paid the penalty. There he made an end of sin. What did become of the sinner's sin?" Andreessen says, "It simply ceased to exist. When he, by the grace of God, gave up his sin, when he received forgiveness and cleansing, when he heeded the admonition, 'Go and sin no more,' sin came to an end. There was no more sin, no more uncleanness, no more transgression. It had vanished. Christ had done a complete work. At the conclusion of the judgment, Even the record is blotted out, and sin can no more come to mind. What happened in this case of the supposed sinner happens in the case of every truly converted person. Christ takes entire charge. He takes the sin and its punishment. He forgives and cleanses. He creates a new heart and mind, and the sinner, that's you and me, becomes an entirely new creature, and the sin is no more. And I'm sure all of us can testify to the fact that once the sin that once caused us agony of 1,000 times being attempted, 1,000 times resisting, and maybe 1,000 times more not resisting that sin. And I know it was in a temper in me decades ago. Every time I was so sad and cried for forgiveness and help, and God changed me and gave me a new heart. Now, it's true I can still be tempted in that way, but when it's all over, the judgment is over, and the record is gone, that is gone from my heart also. This is from Leslie Harding. Shadows of His Sacrifice, Studies in the Sanctuary. Quote, in this ritual of the two goats, and stop for just a minute, this quote, the way he worded this was so profound to me, and it made so much sense. That I want to share it with you. In this ritual of the two goats, the completion, the climax of all the ceremonies of the plan of salvation was reached. Azazel is a symbol of the devil. When the whole work had been completed in type, the guilt was laid upon him. Next slide. We use the word bear to describe Azazel's part. He was to bear the guilt into the wilderness. We say too, Christ bore our sins. The words are used accurately, but the connotation we place on each is different. Unless he is careful, the superficial reader may think that we Adventists make Azazel our sin bearer, but that is silly. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. Azazel never died in the ritual. The wages of sin is death. Azazel did not die. Next slide. In the wilderness, he was to adumbrate, which means represent, Satan. This scapegoat was to represent Satan during the millennium. For 1,000 years, Satan will be in a land not inhabited. The universe will look down and say, is this the man that made the earth to tremble? Quoting Isaiah 14, 16. Now, here's an illustration from Harding. And Andreessen uses this illustration also, so Harding probably got it from him. But this auditorium, and Harding was speaking to a group in an auditorium, this auditorium may grow very warm. And I ask one of the ushers to open a window. So he takes a pole, these are high windows, to push open the window. And as he does so, a foot darts out and trips him, a mischievous foot. He plunges the end of the rod through the window and it's broken. Who broke the window? Why, we all know it was the usher who broke the window. But we didn't see that mischievous foot come out and trip him up. So, with the sinner, we see him sin, but we do not always see the foot that has tripped him. The tempter must be exposed to the universe when all his work is completed. Oh yes, we have sinned, we must die, but Christ died for us, for everyone. He does not only bear the sins of the righteous, Christ has borne every sin of every man that ever came into the world. The purpose of the ceremony with Azazel is to point out to the universe that Satan is the instigator of all sin. And so how does Azazel illustrate to the universe that Satan is the instigator of all sin? Point one, the high priest lays his hands on the head of the scapegoat and confesses. The Bible tells us all the iniquities of the Israelites, all their transgressions, in all their sins. But atonement, remember, atonement had already been made before the high priest does this. The atonement was made through the blood of the bullock and through the blood of the slain goat. This is the complete package of sins that is laid on the head of the scapegoat. All the iniquities, transgressions, all their sins, it's all laid there. But atonement for them, without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin. And that had already been done. What the high priest placed on the head of the scapegoat is the guilt for all the iniquities, all the transgressions, and all the sins. Satan is the instigator of them all. In these services of cleansing, we see the complete method by which God proposes, and this is a quote from Harding, proposes to remove guilt. And Harding says, this is the profoundest transaction, the most thrilling event in the history of the universe. And the reason he can say this is because this ends everything. The Lamb has been slain from the foundation of the world, yes, Revelation 13, 8. But this symbolizes this placing of all this guilt on Azazel and sending him out symbolizes the close of this sinful world and the great controversy between Christ and Satan. And Harding says it is the most profound of all the transactions that occur in the sanctuary services. This closure on the Day of Atonement, first atonement days, Day of Atonements. First atonement is made by the high priest, by the slaying of the bullock and the goat. And then all the guilt is placed on the scapegoat and sent away. And this represents the end of all things, the end of sin, so to speak. Now, one little nice quote that I want to insert here on slide 26 says, the only question, and this is Ellen White in the new releases I found as I was studying, the only question asked in the judgment, do you know what it is? The only question when we come up with Jesus as our mediator before the Father in the judgment is, are they obedient to my commandments? Mm-hmm. That's all the Father wants to know when we come into that judgment scene. Are you, am I obedient? And if the answer is yes, we pass, so to speak. And if it's no, we have failed. Everything is on this foundation, have we been obedient? And it's not because we are powerful and we can do this. We have learned to turn to Jesus and ask his help in every temptation we meet. And Ellen White tells us over and over that Satan cannot overcome any one of us when we turn to Jesus for help. He trembles when we pray. Now, but I want to go on and close. This is an important closure. Leviticus 16:10 tells us that this scapegoat makes an atonement. What are we talking about? Remember, in Hebrews 9:22, it says, without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. And this scapegoat has not shed any blood. So, in that sense, there can be no atonement by this scapegoat. The bullock and the first goat were offered as sin offerings. They symbolized the atonement. Leviticus 16:20 also says an end of reconciling had been made by the high priest in the sanctuary. And then he puts his hands on the scapegoat and confesses all these sins. Romans 14:11 says, and let's look at Romans 14:11, and we have to quick pretty soon. 14:11 says, "For it is written, as I live, saith the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall confess to God." So let's just look at some quotations from Great Controversy. This is from page 670. With all the facts of the Great Controversy in view, the whole universe, both loyal and rebellious, with one accord declare, "Just and true are thy ways, thou King of saints." That's a quotation from Revelation 15:3. Let's read another quotation from page 668 of Great Controversy. "As if entranced, the wicked have looked upon the coronation of the Son of God. They see in his hands the tables of the divine law, the statutes which they have despised and transgressed. They witness the outburst of wonder, rapture, and adoration from the saved. And as the wave of melody sweeps over the multitudes without the city," this is after the 1,000 years when the holy city descends, "when they see this, the wicked who are without the city, including Satan and his angels, all with one voice acclaim, 'Great and marvelous are thy works, Lord God Almighty, mighty, just and true are thy ways, thou King of saints.' And falling prostrate, they worship the Prince of Life." One more quote from 670, Great Controversy. "Satan." What about Satan? They all fall and worship. What about Satan? "Satan sees that his voluntary rebellion has unfitted him for heaven. He has trained his powers to war against God. The purity, peace, and harmony of heaven would be to him supreme torture. His accusations against the mercy and justice of God are now silenced. The reproach he has endeavored to cast upon Jehovah rests wholly upon himself. And now Satan bows down and confesses the justice of his sentence." And there are more quotes that that will be in the file as I put down there. But here, brothers and sisters, is where atonement is, where we are all rebellious and saved. The whole universe, Satan including, confess to the rightness of God, his justice, his mercy, his beautiful character. Satan bows down. And as Pastor told us a few weeks back, he explained this to us in one of his sermons, that this is what is meant by the atonement, that the scape
with him, not for us, but with him.
With him, not for us. How this atonement occurs and what it means for the scapegoat to make an atonement with him. It's when he bows down, he, the instigator of every lost soul, every lost angel, when he bows down and confesses that, how does Ellen White say it, the justice of his sentence, then the whole universe finally is at peace and harmony with God our Father and Jesus our Savior. And that's where we'll close. Let's have prayer, shall we? Father, we know that each one of us is lost without the great sacrifice of Jesus, without the atonement he provides for us so that we can face you in peace and with joy. And we thank you for this great gift. And we know, Father, it is of no account or anything good in us that has done this. It's only your goodness and your love for us, that agape, that agapo that you give us all the time. Please, Father, help us to return this great love to you and to share this great benevolence you've given us with others. Give us, Father, the mind of Christ, and help us to be strong and faithful so that we would rather die than to sin, Lord, because that's the place we need to be at in order to meet Jesus without seeing death. And I thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. And until we meet again, may God watch between us. Thank you for joining us, each one of you.